I'm Dr. John Zeisel. I believe that staying engaged in our communities, that continuing to learn, and that knowing we can make a difference, hope, are the secrets of successful aging. Hello, I'm Dr. John Zeisel, and welcome to Hopeful Aging. Our mission is to create a life worth living for all of us as we get older, and especially those with cognitive challenges, by enriching lives and offering hope. Our guest today is Ginny Mazur. Ginny is a community partnership director at Goddard House, which is the third oldest elder service organization in the country, the first, the oldest in Massachusetts, having been founded in 1849. Welcome, Ginny.
Thank you, John. It's great to be here.
Thank you. So we exchange a lot of emails, and at the bottom of your email, you have a signature that always comes up after your name and address. It's a quote by Gene Cohn, who was one of the leaders in creative thinking and the promoters of creativity as we age. And what he writes is, there is no denying the problems that accompany aging, but what has been universally denied is the potential. The ultimate expression of potential is creativity. So why do you have it at the bottom of every one of your emails?
I have it because I believe it, and in a way I've adopted it as my motto, and it's not adopted from Dr. Gene Cohn as much as it's been my life's work for the past 20 years. And you know, I think, John, that we live in a culture that is a culture that denies aging. We can call it an ageist culture, any number of things. But I don't think all generations stop and look, whether at the bottom of the email every day, to consider what's good about aging. What is the potential that it holds? And to start with, older age is 40 years, roughly, age 60 to 100.
Right.
Now, that's huge. It's vast.
Yeah.
And it's several different life phases. And I think what Dr. Cohn was getting at is that there's just a lot of room to explore, to grow, to change, to develop, and to create. And by create, he meant specifically to use the arts, being all different types of art forms, to find meaning in life, to reflect on who you are, who one is, and what's important to you.
We're living a lot longer than people used to. I was just passing a cemetery, and there's the grave of Alexander Hamilton, who's a great leader in the American Revolution and setting up this country. How old do you think he was when he died?
50?
47. Mm-hmm. I was looking at that, I said, wow, look at how much they accomplished. Had he been alive today, he would have had another 50 years to live.
Yeah.
And what would he have done then? And what you're saying is, with that newfound life, we can't just say, that's it. And when you talk about the importance of creativity, that's really the basis of hope, isn't it? To be able to say, there is something in my life with some meaning.
Right, to find meaning, and people do find meaning in different ways, but I guess I would say it's not even just through the arts that we are creative. There's all different ways that we can find meaning.
And what are the big three or four items for you that provide meaning in life in general, but in your life?
In my life? Well, the first thing I would say without a doubt is people. My friends, my family, the relationships that I have.
Yes.
They're the charge, and that charge can be positive, it can be complicated, it can be negative.
Right.
But we keep each other going.
So relationships is the first one.
Yeah, and part of relationships is also community.
Yes.
It's not isolated. Immediately, almost, when you're in a relationship, you're in community, whether you go to the grocery store or whether it's with your family.
Yes.
Because there's so much interconnection in life.
So at Goddard House, talking about community, you're building a community not only with people who live there, but also with people in the surrounding area.
Right.
You have, you have something called a passport program.
Yep.
Where people in the community can get a passport and then participate in the many activities that there are at Goddard House.
Right. The passport is an entryway to Goddard House to come in to enjoy lectures, concerts, fitness programs, all different types of programming that we offer.
Right.
And a community member just needs to give us a call to say that they're interested in that, to sign up, and they're welcome.
But at the same time, you take people who live in Goddard House out into the community. Among other things, there's a walking program.
Mm-hmm.
That actually is part of my foundation's It Takes a Village program. It's a collaboration, in a sense.
Yeah.
And which is wonderful. So it's not only people coming into this institution or organization, it's also the people there getting out. Where do they go? What is this walking program? How does it work?
The It Takes a Village walking club, it's called Nature Adventures in Your Own Backyard.
Oh.
It's one of the many partnerships we have at Goddard House, and partnerships are so important that that's my job title. They're written into our mission at Goddard House. But this partnership came from an idea to have a group,
right,
a community group, where people who have dementia, their care partners, and anybody else who wants to come, go on a walk. Sometimes guided, sometimes just lightly guided. The
yes.
main pleasure is the walking itself.
Well, before you go on, we know that one of the things we know for sure about the whole non-pharmacologic approach to getting older and also to cognitive issues is exercise.
Mm-hmm.
One thing we know is taking a walk
mm-hmm.
and getting exercise is one of the clearest ways to delay many of these symptoms.
Mm-hmm. Well, the walking club, we've explored this year. This is the pilot year of the program.
Yes.
Year one, we've had taken six walks around and near Boston.
Okay, so where did you go in Boston?
Oh, we went to the Arnold Arboretum, the Boston Public Gardens, the Route 9 Reservoir in Chestnut Hill, the Holy Transfiguration Monastery
wow.
in Chestnut Hill,
That's
which
great.
Is a hidden gem. Jamaica Pond.
So what you're really doing is setting up a model for any community to get out, get exercise, and be part of the community.
Right. That's right.
Right. Because every community has a public park or a beautiful cemetery, which
yeah.
many people use for bird watching or an arboretum or a pond to walk around.
Yep, absolutely.
So,
and any community can obviously do it.
Yes.
And we're writing about this model a little bit as we go along. But the fact that it's in nature is something that we're learning is so important.
You could find a gym and walk around in a circle.
Exactly.
That wouldn't do it.
No, there's something
what
different
here. What is there about
here.
Nature? What do you think it's about nature that is healing?
Well, and I think you just said it. There's something intrinsically healing for all of us, not just the person with Alzheimer's disease. To go out and take a walk.
Yes.
It sounds simple, but many things happen.
Like, why nature? Why versus walking around inside?
We're outdoors, we feel the sun, the wind, we meet up with dogs, with babies, with
yes.
musicians, with goats on our last walk.
Wow.
And so that's fantastic. And we're part of the natural world, the earth. We feel that connection to the outdoors, and in some way we receive healing, I think, from being outside.
So we really need to get communities to embrace having older people with dementia together, caregivers, outside in the community, because the other side of the coin from you going out is there have to be an embracing of old age in the community itself to welcome
yes.
them.
Yes, and we have been welcomed that way. I
oh,
must say, a lot of people have interacted with us and smiled and even hugged people spontaneously. So there is a great deal of interaction. And another thing that is so important, and I've not read a lot of the research, but something magical happens in that dementia falls away. As we're
yes.
walking, it doesn't matter who's who. Anymore.
Right.
And that's another aspect of Mother Nature. There's something very leveling
yes.
about it.
There's a lot of, I know that one of your interests and one of my interests is meditation.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
One of my teachers, Thich Nhat Hanh, in retreats when we do meditation, does walking meditation, very slow walking in nature. And part of it is that when you're in nature, you can't be worrying about what happened yesterday or what's going to happen tomorrow. It's very immediate and very present, which means that the state of having, not being able to remember names, for example, or exactly what we had for breakfast, it doesn't matter.
Right.
Because it's so immediate. Nature really surrounds us, doesn't it?
Right, it encompasses us. We have to slow down. We also become receptive.
Yes.
You know, look at the difference in our culture. It's go, 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 do, do, do. But we don't emphasize just being. We don't emphasize receiving things in life. So nature being, we also realize we're part of a much greater sense of things. We're a little blip on the screen. We both kind of simultaneously feel how small we are and also how connected we are to things.
I know that one of the places that you do meditation is at the Insight Meditation Center in Cambridge.
Yeah.
And there's a teacher, his name is Larry Rosenberg, a meditation teacher, a Buddhist teacher, and he's written this book called Three Steps to Awakening.
I haven't read it yet.
You haven't read it yet.
Has it just come out?
Just come out about 6 months ago. And there's two things in there that make sense in terms of what you're talking about. The first is this question of relationship. He says, if you can't create a positive relationship, you can't know who you are. We are who we are in relationship. It's not just, you know, we're here and as isolated people. So he says that in every relationship and situation, you have the opportunity to figure things out, to be responsive. And that's the second thing he talks about, is the difference between reacting and responding. I had a minister in Carlisle, where our kids grew up and where we lived at the time, who used to talk about stones react, people respond. And we really have to be present to responding to each other, which must be an important part of your work as well.
In the context of work at Goddard House?
Yes, well, or in life, in your relationships.
It definitely is all over the place. I will say this, in my work at Goddard House, I've learned to slow down, and the older adults have taught me this. I mean, working with older people, the average age at Goddard House, sometimes, right now it's younger, but sometimes it's around age 90.
Wow.
And
that's great.
I ask, what keeps people so hopeful? What keeps people so vital?
What does keep people so hopeful at age 90? What does keep people so vital?
Well, I think it's not just one thing, but it's a combination of things.
Yes.
It's the human capacity to engage and re-engage, to love again, even if you sustained numerous losses, which most people at age 90
have.
And it's just stunning. The other thing is, I think older age brings about a freedom. And a freedom that I've, you know, people in their 80s and 90s, they often talk about this. And if you look at photographs of them when they were in their 50s and 60s, they'll often look older.
Yes, isn't that interesting?
Have you ever noticed that?
Well, because they just relax, their faces relax, the wrinkles go away.
Exactly. And I started interviewing people a little bit about that and saying, why is this? And they said, because back then, my husband had died, I was trying to manage a house, my son was going through a divorce. Now my time is my own, and it is so precious that I do what's most important to me. I cut to the chafe of life, and I've never lived closer to life before.
Which really is a message of meaning. In other words, I found meaning in my life.
I found my meaning, my ways of having meaning.
Well, it's really one of the benefits of getting older, which is we get wiser so that we can focus more on what is important and not worry so much about wasting our time on what isn't important to us.
Right.
Did you have a role model for elders in your life?
I did. It was my grandmother.
Your grandmother.
Ida Buckley Murray. She was, I loved her. I loved her so much. She was, I would say, that kind of gave me a sense of home. in my early life. She was wildly imaginative. She was a designer, and she owned a hairdressing salon. She was a fashionista of her day.
Right.
Wildly glamorous. In fact, we called her Glamma.
Glamma.
Instead of Grandma. But Ida taught me the power of using one's imagination to explore yourself. And what I didn't know at the time was that she had cancer, and that she was dying of cancer, and she died when I was age 9.
So all of this influence was before you were 9 years old.
Yeah. And she would use imaginative stories to take us on a journey together, or to travel,
yes,
or to go places, which physically she could not do. But we could do that together in our imaginations. We would travel to places like New York City and Radio City Music Hall, which her father had designed the interior of.
So in a sense, she was telling stories that you could touch.
Right.
Actually, there's another person we're interviewing, Alan O'Hare,
yep,
who's a storyteller. He talks about that, how mm-hmm. important that is for all of us. So when you say a role model, how is that a role model? How did that come out? How did people know she was a role model for you?
Well, she was a role model because that imaginative sense invoked in me that same creativity that Dr. Jean Cohen,
yes,
is talking about.
So when you were little, what did you want to be when you grew up?
Grandmother.
you wanted to be a grandmother?
Yeah, I wanted to be a grandmother because I thought a grandmother was that, almost like one who evokes magic, one who evokes the story, one who sparks your imagination and takes you to places that you've never been.
Well, I don't know anybody who, when asked, what do you want to be when you grow up, said, I want to be a grandmother.
You don't?
but that, now I know you. But it's an inspiration because mm-hmm. what you're saying is, you had that hope and you had that vision and insight,
right,
into old age when you were 5,
mm-hmm.
which I think is one of the reasons that what we do really needs to be communicated to young people.
Mm-hmm.
That we have to communicate to young people hope. The hope that when you're older, you actually have wisdom, you don't waste your time on meaningless things, and that you can share that long life of yours. Again, whatever level of cognitive ability you have,
mm-hmm.
Because even people with dementia can tell stories. They tell great stories.
And you know what's fascinating? You're absolutely right about that. And what's fascinating is that young children often come to Goddard House with some type of a preconception of what they're going to meet up with there.
Yes.
And they're oftentimes scared. Then when they walk through the door.
That's right. They come and they say, what's going to happen?
Right. Is this going to be scary? Is this going to be somehow really weird for me?
Yes.
And it isn't. It's usually wonderful for them. And kids are unabashedly, they jump for joy. They say, this is a great place. I want to live here when I'm old. And kids then meet older adults, talk with them immediately, meet them as a person,
yes,
and connect. And so age, that the biases that even very young children in our culture have about age are quickly kind of washed away by developing a real relationship and a real,
yes,
connection with older people. And I agree with you so much that we need to do that more.
Yes.
Many kids, they don't have their grandparents around.
Well, as you know, I wrote a book, I'm Still Here, which is really about the fact that that person is always there and that we should never count out somebody who's older, somebody who happens to have cognitive challenges. They're always there. They can always find themselves, and young people can always have a connection.
Mm-hmm.
What about books? Are there writers that also have informed your I mean, Gene Cohen is obviously one of them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, do you know the name of his book, what this comes from?
Gene Cohen's book is called The Creative Age.
The Creative Age.
And he passed,
yes,
away just several years back,
yeah,
in his 60s. He was very young. But out of his work sprang the National Centers for Creative Aging in Washington, D.C. And you can go to their website,
yes,
creativeaging.org, to find a wealth of wonderful connections,
yes,
and information.
There's a there's a the director of that, a woman named Gay Hanna, ran an excellent conference of, in 2014, I think. Mm-hmm. And in it, there was a lot of discussion about how the different ways that creative aging can come to play. Mm-hmm. And it was really an homage to Jean, because there were many of the students and many of the people who had inspired him who came and spoke about him.
Yeah.
I met his wife, mm-hmm. who's also a very creative person. So it was a real pleasure to be there.
She's an art therapist,
and
isn't she?
She's an art therapist, I think,
yeah.
too. So
books.
What are the other books? Yeah, I was going to say books. So Jean's creative, what is it again?
The Creative Age, by Dr. Jean Cohen.
Is one of the other books that have informed you or that you believe we should
all
be aware of?
Yeah, two books. And these books potentially can lead you to many others. But the first one is a book by Dr. Bill Thomas, a gerontologist, called Second Wind. And
it's one of his new books, right?
One of his new books. Right. And in his earlier books, Dr. Thomas, who is the creator of the Eden Alternative,
yes.
which is a model for long-term care nursing homes, whereby the residents of those nursing homes are empowered
yes.
and lead much more proactive, active, and engaged lives.
He's a real leader in this movement for the non-pharmacologic creations and creativity and personhood of
right.
everybody, whether they're in institutions or not.
One of the founders.
Right.
But now, it's hitting closer to home for him. Second Wind is really about himself and about the baby boomer generation and looking at this kind of new horizon of older age that we're embarking upon, which he believes is going to has the potential to be different than any other. However, he sees us right now at a really big crossroads, because he sees three kind of contingents in our culture,
right.
In Western culture. And those contingents are the denialists, people who just say, oh, I'm not even going to talk about it. The realists, who are people who realize that they are aging, they accept it, but they fight it back. They do everything they can, whether it's taking vitamins or going to the gym.
Right. What's the third one?
The third is the enthusiasts. And these are people who, kind of with an open heart and an open mind, are thinking, what is this going to be like?
So this sounds more like most like what you promote, which is embracing aging, be enthusiastic about it. Don't just say it's not there or I'm going to fight it.
Right, to embrace it, to explore it,
sure.
to be realistic.
So another book that you mentioned to me, Ginny, was that influenced you was this book with a great title called From Aging to Saging.
Mm-hmm.
Who's it by and why is that so important to you in your work as well, in your life?
From Aging to Saging is by Rabbi Zalman Schachter Shalome. And this book is, I would say, could be called a Bible of sorts by Dr. Bill Thomas on aging.
So they're both related.
Yeah, he mentions it in his book Second Wind as the book that he's returned again and again and again to study and to draw from its resources.
Is there a specific sort of strong message in Aging to Saging?
Yes, Rabbi Shalome says that we need to develop a philosophy of what aging is, that we're really adrift in our culture, to understand the benefits of philosophy of what does aging offer us.
Yes.
And he talks about a concept that really resonated with me, which he calls the interiority of ourselves.
Interiority of ourselves, and what do you think he means by that, and how do you interpret that?
I think what he means is that aging gives us time to go deep, to go within, to look inside, to draw from inner resources that we simply might not have the time to do
yes.
when we're younger people and we're having to make a living and
well,
raise
we may
kids.
Not, we may not only not have the time, but not have the experience.
Mm-hmm.
And so this really is saying take advantage of your life.
Right.
So that in old age, you can both learn more about yourself, but also you can share yourself with others and be in relationship.
Absolutely. He doesn't just, that's so important, John, that you mentioned that part. He calls it harvesting your life.
Isn't that great? Harvesting your life. No, that's a lovely phrase.
Yeah.
Does he talk about creativity at all, creative expression?
He talks about everything.
How do you, let's jump to what you think about expressive arts and creative expression, and how you might have built on these books and on these experiences.
Well, going all the way back to Ida and that creativity that
Ida,
I felt,
your grandmother.
My grandmother that I felt as a youngster. I think her influence was what led me many years later to becoming an expressive arts therapist, which has been a great fit as a profession for me. And it's always, even though my work is more administrative at Goddard House, it's always a part of the work that I do. And by expressive arts, I mean different art modalities, be it life storytelling, visual art, music, dance, and movement that are used to bring meaning to life, whether it's exploring oneself, whether it's building a community, understanding relationships between people. And it's one of the most vital things. I think I've used the expressive arts again and again in my own life.
Well, actually, you know, first of all, two things interesting that you're saying, and one is this idea that the arts are, it's not art, it's the creative arts.
Mm-hmm.
Part of It Takes a Village is we've had cooking classes, because we talk about the culinary arts.
They are arts.
And really, meaning has to be found in culture and creativity always, which is why it's such a shame when those are the programs that get cut from grammar schools. Because if we don't learn it when we're young and get involved in the arts as you're using them, we may not be ready to use them in old age when we really need them.
Mm-hmm. And don't you think that there is an important interplay between what the individual experiences and the fact that they're with other people and that they're in community?
Absolutely.
In the context of sharing the arts?
So jumping to what you just said about individual experiences, I know that you use the expressive arts in your own life, mm-hmm. and at periods of grief as well.
Yeah.
And I know you showed me something that you had written at that point. Tell me a little bit about it, and why don't you read it to me and thus our audience.
10 years ago, my husband Bob Mendenhall died when he was 45 years old of Lou Gehrig's disease, a very hard illness, and it was nothing that, you know, no one ever foresees that in life. And so what I did, I began about 6 months after he died to write 30 minutes every week, just write. And I called it the Little Light Project because it gave me hope.
So being involved in the expressive arts yourself by writing gave you hope and gave you meaning.
It gave me hope
even when I was in the depths of grief. Right, even in this dark time.
Yeah.
Why don't you read it for us?
So I'm going to read a little piece here that was written about 1 year after Bob died, when I find myself coming back to life. It's called Apples and Sand. The trees are weighted with ripe apples here in Little Compton, Rhode Island. I ride my bike by an orchard and watch them fall off the tree. That's the pace of things down here. The fragrance is wonderful. Apples, sea, earth, flowers, and yes, even the cows, not necessarily in that order. It depends which road you take. I've taken them all this trip. I'm breathing in all this life and beauty that is so abundant at the harvest time. Fields of pumpkins dot the back roads. Fat cats nap on fatter pumpkins. The earth is ripened to perfection just before it falls. That's comforting. I think of all the losses Bob endured, and the loss of him, and how every living thing must do the same. Grapes were picked at the vineyards here a few weeks back. We toasted our wedding and then our 10th anniversary here just two Septembers ago. The grapes that were harvested in that fall of 2002 are now a wine that perhaps someday I'll taste. The sweet taste of that September day will never leave me. I imagine popping a cork and everything coming back to me, just for a moment. The hot sand beneath my feet grounds me and shifts, reminding that nothing really stays the same. I rest here deeply and begin to move towards being healed with these small steps. I slow down to feel the sand between my toes. I sift through an orchard of memory and breathe into the expanse. The grains of sand become the beach, the apple, the whole grove. Harvesting life and going round the seasons again, I'm beginning to feel at home once more. The prospect of winter doesn't seem quite as awful this year. I know a candle will be lit in my house. But that's not now. That is another season. Now is the aroma of apple and warm, grainy, falling support of sand.
On that note, Ginny, thank you for joining us. And thank you for showing everybody in the audience how the expressive arts can heal. So thank you so much for being with us. And thank you all for joining us at Hopeful Aging. And come back again.